It's another busy week in Trump land. Poor Donald. Screw that. He's getting what he deserves, I think. There's so much to talk about, but Marcy Wheeler, I think we have to start today with the news story that you broke. In fact, a bombshell story. The reporting at emptywheel.net was posted with a smoking gun headline. FBI didn't have sufficient evidence to prosecute firearms crimes against Hunter Biden. You published that yesterday. You told us about it before. My question for you, did anybody else in the media pick up on your story?
No, or the under, I mean, the bigger surprise. I mean, the bigger problem is they didn't catch up to the underlying issue, which is that 81 days after indicting Hunter Biden, David Weiss, who's now a special counsel, decided to, for the first time in over 5 years of investigating him, get a warrant to access the iCloud content that they already had to go look for evidence of this crime. And it's a procedural thing. They're in a place right now where they're arguing, oh yeah, we are always planning on charging you with gun crimes. And there's good reason to believe David Weiss wasn't always planning it, and that the only reason he did is because Jim Jordan demanded it. And this is very compelling evidence that that's true, that they did not bother to access content that they had had for years. All it would have taken was a warrant, right? And they could have gotten it 2 years ago. They could have gotten it 3 years ago. They could have gotten it 4 years ago. They didn't bother to do that in all that time. And that's a testament, really, that they really just weren't going to charge him with gun crimes, and then decided after the big political campaign to do so. And so those motions to dismiss in the Hunter Biden case are all briefed up, and we'll see what Judge Noreika in that case wants to do. But the other thing that's going on, I mean, the reason I wrote that smoking gun is because earlier in the week, so last week, Hunter Biden's gallerist, his art dealer, former art dealer, because he kind of let him go, testified to the House. And he basically, you know, he basically said Hunter Biden was never getting paid for paintings as much as this Washington Post story in 2021 claimed. And therefore, as much as the entire theory that Hunter Biden is laundering money and influence to his father through these $500,000 paintings. In fact, what we learned is that the paintings, that the highest payment for a painting he got was something like $85,000. Mm-hmm. We learned that the gallerist was getting threats. We learned that simply carrying Hunter Biden as an artist cost the gallerist quite a bit of money. And so I think on Monday, Ben Smith had an interview with the new publisher of the Washington Post and said, Will Lewis, and he said, you know, how do you manage to avoid getting a partisan brand like others? And it was a stupid question because, like, the only outlet that has a partisan brand, besides ones that are, like, affirmatively partisan, like, you know, this American Prospect or something, is MSNBC. No one else has a partisan brand. And Will Lewis says, he points to this article from Matt Visor, who's one of two of Washington Post's main dick pic snippers. And he says, this is an example. And what that article was an example that the Washington Post is not correcting themselves when their manufactured scandals turn out to be debunked. So that one, Matt Visor, like in that interview with Georges Bergès, the gallerist, he said that Weiser's earlier article came up four times. And there was one exchange where a Republican congressman was like, so let me read you the passage from the Washington Post. Are you telling me this is false? And the gallerist straight out said, that is false. I never said that. So in other words, like, you know, that the gallerist said that that article in 2021, false, based off an entire false premise. And Matt Visor in 2021 called up all sorts of art critics, said, what do you think, is Hunter Biden worth $500,000? They said, oh my God, that's really inflated. Called up all these ethics advisors, said, what do you think about Hunter Biden getting $500,000 per painting? Oh my God, with inflated prices like that, it sure looks like an ethical problem. Well, guess what? He was never getting paid $500,000. The entire premise was wrong. Will Lewis points to that. This is an example of us not being partisan. I'm like, no, this is an example of you lying.
Right.
This is an example of you refusing to do basic ethical corrections when your manufactured conspiracy theories, your manufactured scandals about Hunter Biden turn out to be wrong. And then the other one. So the reason I called that a smoking gun, besides because it's all about guns, this is, you know, until we move to the tax crimes in California, I'm going to make fun of the guns ones.
Okay.
You know, remember Devlin Barrett, he gets an October surprise every second October, every election year. Right wingers call him up and tell him what to say as if it's true. And he does it. And, you know, he was the one in 2016 who turned a non-story about the Clinton Foundation investigation into a leak mm-hmm. that was one of the many things that contributed to Hillary Clinton's loss.
Right.
And we later learned, you know, that it was not true. This was the basis Trump used to fire Andy McCabe when he challenged that. DOJ settled with him. And then in 2022, again, and this is what started the entire conspiracy theory that we're now working through in the House. He published an article with Perry Stein saying, oh, you know, they've got evidence for tax crimes and gun charges. It's up to David Weiss to see if he's actually going to charge it. And that's what really kicked off this entire campaign that indeed led to Hunter Biden being charged days before the 5-year statutes of limitation expired. And this effort after the fact to collect evidence that they had never bothered to collect before because they weren't going to charge him. Because it doesn't, you know, like one of the points that Abby Lowell made, his attorney made he had some filings come out on Tuesday. He's like, DOJ is well established that for a recovering addict like Hunter Biden, mm-hmm. the outcome is far better if he's sober to keep him out of jail than to put him into jail.
Right.
Like, and you've decided that Hunter Biden has to go to jail to appease Jim Jordan and Donald Trump.
Yeah. You know, the whole thing, this story, this smoking gun story that you broke at emptywheel.net this week goes back to the beginnings, this October of 2022, Devlin Barrett, Washington Post story, claiming that the Fed had enough evidence to charge Hunter Biden with a false statement tied to purchasing the gun in 2018, when Biden was admittedly at the time smoking crack. And now you've through your research and your investigations, found out that they got the indictment or the warrant after the fact. That
81 days after the fact. 81 days after the fact. And you know, they're, yeah, 81 days after the fact.
That's amazing.
And when they revealed that they had gotten that warrant to Abby Lowell, again, Hunter Biden's attorney, they didn't tell him, here's where we found that particular text. And it's not yet clear. Abby Lowell's going to move to suppress that warrant, which is going to be interesting, because then we're going to get into what Abby Lowell knows about the laptop and what the FBI believes they know about the laptop. But the point is that, like, the only outlets that reported on this warrant obtained after the fact, much less the prosecutor in that case, you know, he very manipulative of journalists, and it worked like mm-hmm. a charm, because these journalists mm-hmm. are just looking for dick pic snipping. I mean, they are not looking for truth. So the prosecutor was like, oh my gosh, we discovered we had to take a picture of the gun. but he admits this was in 2023, right?
Oh,
but
my God.
He doesn't say.
Okay, so the gun, did they not have pictures of the gun already? Did they not have
no, they
the
did.
Serial
they
number?
Did. Right. And, like, that's so, the thing. They got pictures of the guns in the case file.
Yeah.
And so they didn't need any picture of the gun. So they just made a pretext to say, let's go get some additional evidence from the gun. They sent the gun to the FBI lab and tested it for cocaine residue, but did not test it. Actually, not the gun. It was a pouch.
The pouch that the gun was in, right.
For cocaine residue, but did not fingerprint the gun. So the gun going on 6 years later, never been fingerprinted, and did not test the cocaine to figure out how long had been there. So in other words, like, it could be that the pouch that the cocaine dates to 2016, they didn't check because they don't, you know, they're looking for a story that works. But anyway, in the prosecution filing, they were like, oh, you know, there was literally cocaine on the gun. And I was like, no, what you just told us is you literally never checked. You never sent the gun to the FBI lab in 5 years since the actual alleged crime. And that's a testament that you weren't going to charge it. Since then, we've learned that that pretext to go find more evidence from the gun, that also didn't happen until after the indictment. So you see the indictment in September. You see them use a pretext to go test the gun for cocaine residue in October. In November, they use a grand jury, the tax grand jury in California, to ask a witness about the gun, mm-hmm. which, you know, I talk a lot about acceptable prosecutorial dickishness. And this is the kind of thing they'll get away with, but it's the kind of thing that looks especially stupid if you've been investigating for 5 years and you've never bothered to ask that witness before. So that's November. They grand jury testimony in November. And then in December, Abby Lowell and the prosecutors have a conversation on December 1. And Abby Lowell's like, do you have any evidence about the mindset of my client on the day he bought a gun? And prosecutors then rush out and go get a warrant. And when it was unsealed on Monday, and, you know, pursuant to my request, mm-hmm. when it was unsealed, it had not been returned yet. The FBI was still looking for evidence in Hunter Biden's iCloud content that they've had since 2019.
Wow. Now, when we spoke last Friday, we were waiting. You had written the letter. You asked for the warrants to be unsealed. You hadn't heard back yet. But shortly after we wrapped taping, sure enough, there came the tweet. And you were right. You got it right. And so I expected to see this covered everywhere. Did anybody else?
Fox, New York Post. And they got, by the way, they got an advance notice. Like, I was not told, oh, by the way, the filings that you, and I had to go back and get, I asked for two things. I asked for the warrant itself and what are called the attachments, attachments A and B. Attachments mm-hmm. A say, here's what you can search. Attachments B say, here's what you can search for. And attachment B was important because it was going to show whether the warrant was just for gun crimes, right? The earlier warrants were just for tax crimes. This warrant was for gun crimes. I had to call back to the chambers and say, hey, you know, they haven't fully complied with your order yet. Can we get the attachments loaded? So it was, you know, there were people in that courthouse who were not really happy about the request. And like I said, the FBI had not returned the warrant, had not gone back to the judge and said, okay, we've executed this warrant. We've gotten what we need from the content. And it is not impossible that this agent has been tainted by what he's seen on Fox News and believes he can just go into Hunter Biden, may not understand that what you see publicly, some of that was added after the fact. Mm-hmm. And there may be one or two things that were completely manufactured. And so, like, he said, oh, I found these texts in Hunter Biden's computer. They haven't even this I'm fairly certain about, and it's fairly appalling given that it's the FBI and given that it, you know, when the investigation started, it was the former vice president's son. Now it's the president's son. They haven't done basic things like, you know, they submitted these texts and they said these texts show that he was doing crack the two days after he bought the gun. I'm like, great. Mm-hmm. Which phones did those come from? Because unless you can tell me which phones those came from, you've got a problem, because he lost his phones, two of them, the day before he bought the gun, literally. I mean, wow. Like I've traced this. So loses the phones on October 11th, spends much of October 12th replacing his phones, getting, you know, calling up the insurance or getting online with the insurance Assyrian and trying to get sometime that day buying a gun. And then Weiss is relying on texts from October 13th which is the day before Hunter Biden starts using the new phone he gets on October 14th. So it's like, which phone is it? Because unless you can tell me which phone it was and prove that it's not the people who found Hunter Biden's phone, because like Hunter Biden's work email is being broken into at this time. So, right. You know, like this happens all the time. Hunter Biden was in the state of digital half compromise for the entirety of the time that he was addicted, particularly badly so in 2018. And, you know, prosecutors should have the data to prove when some of this stuff happened, but other stuff, I promise you, they will not be able to prove compellingly because, for example, because we always have to talk about Keith, about Ablo, right?
Yes, Keith will blow me. Yep.
In the period when the laptop, what everyone knows is the laptop, in the period when that was being loaded up, Hunter Biden was staying at Ablo's cottage in Massachusetts and had sketchy access to the internet. Like there's this exchange that happened in early January where it's clear he didn't have access to the internet. And so that, like the way in which you would prove whether he sent those texts in October 2018 is you would look at the GPS coordinates of the phone. You would look at what actual phone was used to send those texts. So you might be able to prove that it was Hunter Biden and not some addict he was with or some addict who had found his phone. But at the moment that Hunter Biden is in Keith Ablo's cottage using his Wi-Fi, how are you going to prove that it's Hunter Biden and not Keith Ablo?
You can't. And the other thing that really, you know, it puts up red flags for me is what the hell was Hunter Biden doing with Keith Ablo, who I only know him from, he was the Fox, you know, resident psychiatric expert, Dr. Keith Ablo, and I have to add the me on the end, but how did Hunter Biden get messed up with him?
That I have a theory about that, but I don't have the answer to that yet.
It's it's creepy. It's weird. So, you know, there are these, and there's this indictment against Hunter Biden. You've been covering it, thankfully.
Two indictments.
And the only reason, I mean, if you look at emptywheel.net this week, it's a lot about Hunter Biden, but out of necessity, because nobody else, all we're getting is the right's spin on it, because none of the left-leaning media really is touching it. And
or even the centrist media. I mean,
or
so
the centrist
like,
media.
Somebody tipped off New York Post. So they wrote the first, like they had the warrants loaded in a New York Post story before they were loaded on the docket that I had access
wow.
to, which thank you. And then Fox piggybacked off their story. And these stories were completely incompetent. I mean, like literally they had no idea what they were looking at. And then a woman from Washington Examiner did a very, very competent story, like,
Washington
you know, right wing outlet. But she did a very competent story. But when she did her story, the attachments A and B that I told you about for the most recent warrant were not up yet. So she didn't know the background. And so she didn't understand that the warrant in December, 81 days after the indictment, was for the crime indicted in September.
Wow.
And so even somebody, you know, at Washington Examiner doing a very competent job couldn't get the story right because of that delay. NBC called, you know, contacted me over the weekend, said, how do I find these? They're not up yet. NBC hasn't done a story. I have not seen a story, you know, like CNN was another outlet. Obviously, Washington Post, of course, fell for I call it the coke and gun ploy by the prosecutor to make a big deal out of the fact that there was cocaine residue in the pouch, but that they didn't look for fingerprints.
Right.
CNN also fell for that ploy. They didn't do a story either. And so it's, you know, like after what Will Lewis, Washington Post's new publisher said, after he said dick pic sniffing is our proof that we're not biased. I wonder whether that's the problem. Like certainly NBC has similarly terrible coverage of Hunter Biden. And I increasingly believe, and this is not true. Like New York Times has had some good coverage. Politico has had some good coverage. But most outlets, of course, they just chase after the story without unpacking it. Like literally, I am the only person who covered the really scandalous parts of the Scott Brady testimony to Congress, which described how he was channeling stuff from Rudy Giuliani into the Hunter Biden investigation.
Right.
It's just amazing.
Well, it's one of many reasons why I'm always telling people you got to read emptywheel.net. Now, there was, you know, we have fun with the dick pics and, you know, thankfully you keep a focus on them. But there was a new term, I guess, coined this week. We've got to thank Marge.
Indictable crimes.
Is she really that stupid? Here's the full sentence.
This historical evidence is overwhelming that the founding fathers intended impeachment to be used to deal with the commission of indictable crimes and the abuse of power.
Indictable crimes.
Yeah, I mean, but this is not the Biden impeachment effort. It's the Mayorkas impeachment effort, which may not pass.
Should hope not. I mean, what, or do they have?
Hembuck has said he's voting against it.
Right.
So it's on a knife edge, really, whether it'll pass. And that's an interesting. I mean, honestly, like, okay, I want to jump ahead and talk about how we still haven't heard from the D.C. Circuit because a lot of people are talking about that.
Yes.
So we're now 3.5 weeks.
Right. Didn't he say that he wanted to have a decision by the end of January? But now we've learned that Alan Weisselberg has pled guilty to perjury. Could this be the holdup?
Oh, so we're talking different things. But yes,
okay.
Engoron is going to issue a ruling on Trump's fortune. There are two things that could be a holdup. Yes, Weisselberg lied on the stand, and they're going after him for perjury charges. Mm-hmm. But it sounds like the last deal, which is that he did not, he's not cooperating. You know, so will it be helpful to go after Trump that he will be admitting to lying on the stand, which is what I don't think the deal is quite done yet, but they're in talks about it. And I think the only thing that gets you is that they gave him a severance package to not cooperate the last time. And both Trump and Don Jr. were in that. Don Jr., I think, is the one who formally approved that.
Uh-huh.
And so that may put the severance package to Weisselberg on the table. But the other thing is that the same special master who waded through Michael Cohen's devices and then Rudy Giuliani's devices was made the special master or the whatever it's called for Trump's businesses, because there was a concern that he was going to start moving money out of New York and therefore avoid the penalties that we expect. And she issued a report, which I suspect was at the request of Engoron in advance of his ruling. And she disclosed that a $48 million quote unquote loan that reporters have been following for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. Like it's been this loan outstanding in Chicago to this, to a shell company. And for years, people are like, what is this? You know, the people who've spent hours and hours and hours going through his books have always said, this is really fishy. We can't figure out what it is. And so finally, in the course of her role as, it's not called Special Master, but I'm going to call it Special Master, okay. Barbara Jones, Trump finally said, there is no loan paperwork. There was never a loan. And now it looks, and that makes it look like tax fraud.
Mm.
Because precisely the thing that they were investigating but did not prove against Hunter Biden. It looks like they gave them, you know, Trump gave himself a loan so as to hide money, so as to not pay taxes on $48 million. And so that may also be part of the holdup, because that gives Engoron yet more justification for, forcing them to liquidate their businesses, to prohibit them from doing business in New York. You know, when the trial was ending, I thought he might prohibit Trump from doing business, but not the fail sons.
Mm-hmm.
This is the kind of thing that plus the settlement with Weisselberg that Don Jr. was involved with, this is the kind of thing that might implicate the sons as well. So that's where that's going.
There are the two, though. I conflated them. So there's the verdict. This, what we're talking about, is in New York. That's the New York civil fraud trial, the $370 million that they're looking for, and to ban the Trump Organization from doing business in New York. The other one that you were talking about, the D.C. Circuit Court, is the appeals ruling on Trump's immunity.
Yeah. Right. And we're still waiting. And a lot of people are correctly stating that at the earliest, that thing is not going to go to trial before June, really. And you're seeing movements in Judge Chitkin's calendar. So and there are two possible things that explain that. One is that it is a far more, I mean, we've been talking about this, Nicole, for the past several weeks,
yep.
right?
Yep.
You have three judges, and all three judges believe different things. People are in a lot of the commentary on this, people are, I think, are forgetting that Michelle Childs, the second Biden appointee, wasn't all that crazy about taking jurisdiction of this, whereas Judge Pan was amenable to that, and Judge Henderson was saw no problem with taking jurisdiction. But because all three judges are in a different place, it means there's not a clear majority. If it were the case that Pan and Childs both said it's clear we have jurisdiction and we're going to go big and say there's no immunity once somebody leaves office, then they could issue their ruling, and Henderson would have limited ability to stop. But Henderson has more ability coming in because she's the senior judge on the panel. But if there's like this weird split decision with all three judges writing their own opinion, where you have a majority between Henderson and Pan that favor weighing in right now, and a majority between Pan and Childs that favor going big, then that would explain why it's taking so much time. It's not as like it. Trump's arguments are terrible. Mm-hmm. Not even Judge Henderson, who's very conservative, bought his arguments. But the decision to these questions, because it's sort of a three-part question, is actually more difficult. So that may explain the delay. Like, I know people are really nervous. That may explain the delay. Or it could be that Judge Henderson has figured out a way to delay it. She didn't want to take this on accelerated path anyway. So, you know, if she could say, I'm going to take until November to write my dissent. Oh, by the way, people are also forgetting there was a decision called Blassingame, which was a very related decision, which is, can a president, a former president, be sued?
Uh-huh.
And that
he can,
said
right?
He could be, right? Because he's being sued for things he did as an office seeker, mm-hmm. rather than as an office holder. In other words, right. So the stuff he did related to January 6th were an attempt to stay in office, and therefore the D.C. Circuit ruled that he could sue. That one took 299 days.
Mm-hmm.
And on that panel, as on this one, there was one Republican. In that case, it was Greg Katsas, who had been in Trump's White House. And so we don't know why that took 299 days. Maybe it was a hard decision, or maybe Greg Katsas found a means to delay. And that actually held up. Judge Chutkan didn't issue her opinion on the immunity until hours after the Blassingame, which I just described, mm-hmm. came out. And so, you know, it at least looks like she had her opinion mostly written and was waiting for Blassingame to make sure there was nothing in Blassingame that was going to seriously override it. But she waited long enough to get a citation into Blassingame. So that already held up the Chutkan decision. And sure, it's possible that Henderson is going to hold this up. That's something, again, that we talked about before the hearing. And it's something I've been warning about.
Right. So Marcy Wheeler, you do an amazing job of keeping all the different lawsuits and trials and hearings and all of Trump's legal tribulations straight. This next week, there's a whole bunch of stuff going on. On Monday, Trump's reply brief is due in the 14th Amendment case that is supposed to have oral arguments at the Supreme Court on Thursday of next week, which also happens to be the day of the Republican Nevada caucuses. And then the following Monday and Tuesday, There are hearings scheduled for the documents case. That's Mar-a-Lago. And then on the 15th, a hearing in Fulton County, Georgia, on a motion to disqualify DA Fani Willis because of something wholly unrelated to any of this stuff, plus a New York hush money case hearing. I mean, all of these things are starting to really pile up, aren't they? And then we have the Republican South Carolina primary on February 24th. So that's just in the next, you know, 3 weeks alone, all this stuff is coming up.
And also, by the way, Jim Jordan subpoenaed Fani Willis for documents related to her financial funding. There's an article in Washington Post that people should really read about Mike Roman, who is the one who launched the show about Fani Willis.
Yes. Yep.
Because he, I brought this up, but I'm glad that it's now there at the Washington Post that people can read, because it lays out how he was basically the Koch spy and then became Trump's spy. Right. And he purportedly was vetting people. This is a really important thing to understand. He was spying on Democrats. Like, it describes how he was using a drone to spy on Democrats, but he wasn't just spying on Democrats. He was spying on Republicans.
He was doing oppo research for Trump and company, right?
And a vetter. But I mean, you know, it was described to me as spying. And he, you know, he's described in the story as coming into a hotel room and demonstrating to his wife how he can spy on the people using the unsecured Wi-Fi at the hotel. And then he's described as working for Don McGahn in vetting in the Trump White House, but vetting of Republicans. And it's like, okay, so you're vetting corrupt Republicans, but somehow all these corrupt Republicans ended up getting nominated anyway. Were you vetting them to prevent corrupt Republicans from getting nominated, or were you vetting them to know the dirt on people that you were installing in the cabinet or throughout the bureaucracy? And that guy is the guy who brought this challenge to Fani Willis. And from the start, I was like, did he discover the alleged affair between her and this guy, Nate Wade, who's one of the prosecutors? And did he discover it by, say, wiretapping her hotel? The article describes him wiretapping other people's hotels. Did he wiretap Fani Willis? Is that how they discovered this alleged affair between Fani Willis and one of the prosecutors she hired? I don't know. That's the first thought I had.
Now, did he wiretap her, or just tap into their Wi-Fi? And what you have, there's a warning about using hotel or other free Wi-Fi, because in the article, in the Washington Post article, I believe, it talks about Mike Roman telling his wife or partner, whoever, how easy it is to pull up anybody else who's on that public Wi-Fi and go into their computer.
Right. And that's the point, is like, all the Republicans know his techniques and know that his techniques include things that include spying. Right. But the other thing to know about Mike Roman, what is his role in this? There's this great line in the Washington Post where it says, this is why you don't indict the oppo researcher. He is the guy who recruited top Republicans from swing states around the country to basically commit a crime. Wow. To basically engage in counterfeit, to engage, to lie to the National Archives. And there needs to be more discussion of how that recruitment process happened, because Trump, yeah, we know that Trump uses threats. We know that Trump, he's trying to get Nikki Haley to drop out, right?
Right.
Before that, he was using the same tactics with Ron DeSantis. With Ron DeSantis, and we talked about this last week, with Ron DeSantis, we know all of these crimes that Ron DeSantis was adjacent to. I mean, one example is Lev Parnas. Right? Mm-hmm. He is one of the recipients of Lev Parnas's laundered Russian money. Another one is the Gillum case. Another one is the Joel Greenberg case. He was one degree of separation from all of that. So it would be child's play for Donald Trump to find some way to criminally expose Ron DeSantis. He kind of claims that he's got that kind of dirt on Nikki Haley. He probably doesn't have as much dirt on Nikki Haley, because Nikki Haley isn't in Florida, which, you know, crime always starts in Florida, it seems, these days. But
of course.
But she's not as obviously corrupt as Ron DeSantis. And so I you know, this is what Trump does. And I think that it just never has gotten that much attention. And like, as an example, you mentioned the Nevada caucuses.
Yeah.
And one of the things that gives me hope is that Republican parties around the country are shattering because the maggots are acting just like Donald Trump.
That's
so
right.
There's this big schism in the Michigan Republican Party. In the Arizona Republican Party, the chair quit. This is your, now
yes,
we're talking
is.
About your state.
Yeah, I know, I can't escape it.
I mean, I don't know if you want to describe it, but the chair quit because Carrie Lake accused him of bribing her.
Right.
And he said it wasn't a bribe, but they selectively altered this recording they made of me. But I'm sure there are more recordings of me out there. And so I'm going to quit now to avoid the rest of the recordings from coming out. In Nevada, the heads of the Republican Party have been indicted mm-hmm. for their role in the fake elector spot. And in Nevada, the illegality of what was a bit clearer than it was, say, in Pennsylvania and Wisconsin, you know, the degree to which people really screw themselves in each of these states is different. But so.
And in Florida, don't forget, in Florida, the head of the Republican Party was ousted because of sexual assault charges.
Yes.
Right?
Sexual assault and three-way.
Yes.
Right. Like these are the people who
with
said
with his wife,
can't
a
have,
Moms for Liberty founder. You know, you can't write this stuff.
We can't have children having access to books that talk about LGBTQ people as normal people. But we're going to have three ways while we're making those arguments.
Right. Oh, I got to tell you, wait, what the latest out of Florida is there are some books with some illustrations that may have like naked kids, you know, innocuous. There's one book called No David, which was a favorite of mine and my daughter's. It was about this mischievous little boy named David who, you know, the mother's always yelling, "No, David." And there's a picture on the cover of David, probably a six-year-old kid, running down the street with a bare butt because he's naked. They want to pull those books off the shelves and draw shorts on little David because you can't see a bare butt. That's what they're doing in Florida now. Sorry, I had to share.
Well, because I made Arizona look bad, so now
that's
you,
right.
have to.
Florida's worse.
but in Nevada, to cater to Trump, they set up this, they split the caucus and the primary. I can't really explain all of this,
right.
But because they split it and Trump got them to cater to him, and now he's pissed about what they did to cater to him, and it's causing a schism in the Nevada party because Trump is trying to, like, Joe Biden successfully didn't put himself on the ballot in New Hampshire.
Right.
He got a better outcome than Trump. And Trump was trying something similar in Nevada. He was trying to get a big win when there were going to be, five people in the race against him. Now that there's only one, he's afraid because he's only on one ballot and not the other. So now the Nevada Republicans are fighting with each other. And so, there's a lot, like, the Republicans are fighting with each other. The Republicans in the House keep going on TV and saying, "We've done nothing. We've done absolutely nothing."
Right.
And it's like, yeah, you are now over a year into this Congress and you have done literally nothing except pursue impeachment of first Joe Biden and then Mayorkas.
Right.
And, we've had more witnesses in the Hunter Biden impeachment and they all keep saying Joe Biden had no involvement in Hunter Biden's business, and of course, the reason Republicans are pursuing these two impeachments rather than pursuing, trying to pass bills is because Donald Trump told them to. And mm-hmm. so now they're going to refuse, over the weekend, the Senate is going to finally release the compromise immigration bill. And the House has already said, we don't want to take that up because it'll help Joe Biden.
And they're saying that part out loud. No, we don't want to give Joe Biden a victory. So the thing that we're saying is the most dangerous, threat to our country. We're just going to let it sit because we don't want to give Joe Biden a victory. It's asinine.
Right. And really, I mean, to the extent that you have problems with immigration, with with the border, there's a funding issue. Mm-hmm. And, you know, whatever else the bill would do is it would fund things. And, you know, the GOP doesn't want to fund the problem that they want to fix. And meanwhile, like, there's this caravan of right wingers, like an attempt to do January 6th 3.0.
Yes.
And it's a flop. It's hilarious.
This is the new trucker convoy. Is this what we're talking about?
Yeah, they're driving to the border, and it's all part of this effort to focus attention at the border. Mm. And these people, I posted a tweet. This one woman was ranting about how the people who are in charge of this aren't committed to the cause. They're just committed to grifting, which is true. Mm-hmm. And I tweeted, I'm like, if 40% of Trumpsters, if MAGAs, came to understand the degree to which all of this is about the grift, then, you know, the election would be over. Because if they come to feel like Trump took advantage of them, Steve Bannon took advantage of them, the Jan 6, you know, martyr Nazis took advantage of them, then it's going to really depress them. It's going to, you know, some of them are going to take up arms. There was the Trump supporter who decapitated his father this week.
Oh my God. Yes. And posed with the picture of the head.
And then, you know, like, there is a significant number of the people who act on Donald Trump's mm-hmm. incitement who are mentally ill, and that guy mentally ill.
Yes.
And it's a terrible tragedy. And you're going to have more political violence, more actual, not just the threats, more political violence. You're going to have more swatting because of it. But one reason why it is so dangerous is these people are armed and these people are mentally ill.
That's
many
right.
Not all of them, but many of them. Enough of them that you know, like the guy, Tyler Taranto, who took Obama's address that Donald right. Trump posted on Truth Social and then started stalking the Kalorama neighborhood in D.C. with weapons in his van, right? Yep. That guy's mentally ill. Yep. And so his, you know, he's screwed because now he did something stupid and threatened a president, and he's being jailed pre-trial.
Good.
But he is somebody who's mentally ill and who Trump, you know, was trying to incite focus on Obama, and he responded to that by literally stalking Kalorama. So we're going to see a lot more of that, but we're really seeing, you know, we're seeing partly through paranoia, partly through incompetence, partly through Donald Trump really, he's out for himself. I mean, like, the other thing that came out this week is the last 6 months of fundraising. And Trump spent $50 million on legal fees last year.
Mm-hmm. $50 million from donors who were contributing to his reelection campaign.
Right. So there's this giant suck of having to pay for Trump's lawyers, and his fundraising actually is sort of underwater already. Mm-hmm. But the RNC had a historically bad fundraising last period as well.
Yep.
And so it's actually, you know, so you've got the really crazy people don't, you know, they're beginning to like, through a combination of I'm talking about the caravan people, through a combination of paranoia about the deep state infiltrating them and a realization that many of the people involved are grifters. That energy is sort of dying off to some degree. It's more individualized through the schism of at least three, probably closer to five swing state Republican parties, through their poor fundraising, through Donald Trump spending. I mean, then the other story this week is that of that $50 million, something like 300,000 or upwards of 300,000 was for a British lawyer. So that he could sue Christopher Steele about the dossier.
And that case, and, was thrown out.
The
this
reason
week.
They tried to sue those who know there's Europe has a Europe-wide privacy law called GDPR. And there have been two lawsuits against Christopher Steele related to the dossier in the UK. And the first one was before GDPR and that failed. But the second one used GDPR and succeeded. And so these Trump lawyers were like, great, we'll use GDPR and we'll sue Christopher Steele. Uh-huh. But the alleged crimes were pre-GDPR. And they had let the statute of limitations on the actual claim expire. So it was a waste of $300,000 all in pursuit of, you know, this frivolous claim against Christopher Steele right. in the first place. Mm-hmm. And you know, so honestly, like, yes, it's not clear we're going to have a January 6th trial, either the Fani Willis one because of Mike Roman's challenge, or and that one would not be done before the election in any case. That's, you know, we're still in process. Okay. Or the Tanya Chutkan one in D.C. because this appeal is delaying it. But I do want people to understand that Trump is destroying the Republican Party all the while. And he himself, you know, like Nikki Haley will not be the nominee, but the longer she stays in, the longer his Teflon falls apart. And, you know, and Republicans in the House, at least, are sort of self-sabotaging.
Right.
They, you know, the vote to replace Santos is next week. And Tom Suozzi looks good in the polls, like the people who are expected to come out to vote support him. So we may have one more Democrat, you know, not the greatest Democrat, right, but we may have one Democrat back in this, you know, so the Republican margins in the House are getting razor thin. And then meanwhile, there was an incredible jobs report for Biden.
Oh my goodness. So just this morning, better than anybody expected. The people at Fox are sort of freaking out. I guess Fox.
And they're admitting it though. They're like, oh my gosh, this is a great jobs report.
That's
all
right.
Like, you know, all of these economists, even people, you know, like even the annoying centrists who are debt scolds, everyone is saying, wow, the economy is in great shape.
You had Jay Powell, the chair of the Fed, who, you know, I question his, he's certainly not a Biden acolyte. You know, I think his interest rate hikes over the last couple of years, maybe, and I'm not an economist. I know how to spend money. That's about it. But I don't think he's been, you know, aiming to help the Biden administration. And he got up yesterday, or as the day before, and said, you know, the economy is good. It's really good. And then this jobs report today was just through the roof, much better than anybody expected. And they revised upwards last month's job numbers as well. So this is what many of the pundits are saying now. It's why the Republicans are going all in on the border, because they can't scream about the economy anymore because there's no there.
And then there's an interesting, Biden took an interesting step this week to start sanctioning illegal West Bank settlers.
Yes, good.
And it's a really minor thing. I mean, like, one of the biggest upside risks that Joe Biden has is that a lot of young voters really, really loathe his Israel policy. And it splits, you know, in Michigan, it could cost him the state because there's so many Arab and or Muslim voters. You know, we'll see what happens, but I've seen some people who talk about how savvy that decision is, because it really puts Bibi in a tough spot. And it puts Bibi in a tough spot while there are legitimate negotiations, even to give Palestinians a state. Like, I'm not suggesting that is going to remedy, you know, 70 years of conflict. But there is a new, because of all of the protest in support of Gazans, of Palestinians, not Hamas.
Right.
It is creating a changed landscape. And people are describing this West Bank thing is at this point minor, but a really important step, because it puts Bibi in a quandary, and you're not going to solve Israel. You're not going to solve this conflict with Bibi there, because Bibi wants Trump to win. Like BB is in the same place as Trump.
And you notice
if he doesn't stay in power, he goes to jail.
Right.
Same with Trump.
Exactly. And you notice that Trump has not come out and said, here's his policy, here's what he would do. He's just standing back and trying to be vague about it all. So
and meanwhile, the Saudis have said they're going to start cutting oil supplies again, which they do every year for Trump because they are basically Trump's employer.
Of course.
So, I know people are really anxious about the D.C. Circuit decision. And I just wanted to talk about the landscape of politics where the Republicans are kind of self-sabotaging. And there are some good things happening with Biden. And then now. We should talk about the worst news of the week, which is that it has been a bloodbath for journalism this week.
Oh, yeah.
You had The Messenger shut down.
Done.
You had Wall Street Journal make sort of frivolous cuts in D.C. You had L.A. Times also basically bloodbath last week. So there's never been a month like January of 2024 for the number of journalists who've been laid off.
Wow.
And The Messenger as a whole was a terrible formula and did in on the Hill some really terrible journalism, but it also employed easily one of the best court journalists in the country, Adam Klossfeld.
Yes,
and
yes,
a number
yes.
of other really good journalists. It employed Eric Geller, who's one of the best cybersecurity journalists. You know, so this is one of the things we're seeing is that outlets that depended on social media for their traffic a year ago now aren't getting that traffic.
Oh, shitter.
And they're laying off.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, like Josh Marshall had a really good piece this week about The Messenger.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, he has succeeded in doing bigger than what you and I have succeeded in doing all these years. Like
right.
he's employed more people and he's
talking
done it sustainably.
Points memo. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. And so he, you know, it's a really interesting thing, but, you know, I have a fair amount of optimism about the election, even though we may not get a big trial of Donald Trump, but we need to solve the journalism crisis.
Oh God. Yes. And I don't know, obviously I don't know the answer or we'd be doing
we'll listen
it.
Listen to you and read me we're doing our part, but you can't have democracy without journalism. And with the bloodbath in journalism in the last month, it's hard to see where responsible political reporting is going to come from in the year ahead. And the other thing, I mean, and this is, I think, partly it's the social media thing, but partly in 2016 and 2020, Donald Trump was a gravy train for the press.
Mm-hmm.
His style of conflict was brilliant for the press. And it's not working this time around, partly because he's not, like, the show is much more depressing and his delivery is off and it's tedious. And so, you know, I think a lot of outlets were like, let's just get to election season. And if we get to election season, Donald Trump will, you know, save us for another 10 months or so.
Right.
Donald Trump is not their savior, which maybe they can stop coddling him. But yeah, that like my biggest caution is not the DC circuit delay in that opinion on immunity. My biggest caution right now is what we do about journalism.
Well, and look, support Emptywheel.net. Support this show. I mean, you're a journalist. I'm not. I'm a talk show host. I try to stay informed and I try to make everything fact-based. And if I get something wrong, I rush to correct it and hope people will correct me if I get something wrong. But you're a journalist and the work you're doing is so important. And I love, again, that you do it. And the American Prospect does it this way as well. No paywall, but please support the work we're doing because it is that important. I think the no paywall is really important. The Daily Beast, I couldn't tell you about their reporting because their paywall is so in your face that it seems like every time I go there to look at a story, you have to, you know, if you're not a paying subscriber, then you can't read it. And today, they have a story about Walt Nuata, who is Donald Trump's body man, who was only hired by Trump after he was fired from the White House, accused of sexual misconduct. Have you heard about this story?
Yeah. And that's Roger Sullenberger, by the way, who is worth the price of admission to Daily Beast,
right,
because he is easily one of the best campaign finance journalists out there. He also, by the way, guy who broke a lot of the Herschel Walker stories. So, yeah. So he's a great journalist. And, you know, I think there were hints of these allegations in the past. It's the counterpart to this ABC story that when the FBI searched Mar-a-Lago back in August 2022, they missed two rooms and we're still looking for 30 boxes of documents and we don't know where theirs went to.
Right.
You know, and that raises questions about FBI coddling of Donald Trump. I'm not surprised by the Walt Nauta allegations. I think that one way or another, Walt Nauta, so long as he's Trump's most trusted valet, he is made. And he has an investment in helping Trump beat the rap.
And the thing is, he's Trump's co-defendant in the Mar-a-Lago documents case, where he has been ordered by the judge not to talk with any of the other co-defendants about the case. He's Trump's body man. Do you really think they're not talking about the case?
Yeah, I mean, look, they're basically in a joint defense agreement, so it doesn't really matter because through their attorneys, they are adopting the same approach and have been. I mean, if it weren't Donald Trump, a defense attorney would have advised Walt Nauta to cooperate back in November of 2022, and he didn't. And that's not necessarily a poor choice for Walt Nauta because the way in which he remains a made man is to remain one of Trump's most loyal advisors if Trump wins re-election.
Right.
If he doesn't, then he'll go to jail. And you know, it's a gamble, but it's a gamble that worked for Paul Manafort. It's a gamble that worked for Roger Stone. It's a gamble.
So far.
You know, it's a gamble that has proven to work in the past. The question is whether it's going to work going forward.
Exactly. Marcy Wheeler, we're coming up to the end of the hour, and I need to mention that I am not going to be here next week because my daughter is coming to town. And so I'm taking vacation for the day she's here. So unless, you know, and again, as happened last week, if we get a ruling in either of these cases that we're expecting maybe any minute, the appeals court ruling on Trump's immunity or the verdict in the New York civil fraud trial, I'll update that at Showtime when this interview airs this afternoon at 5 Eastern to Pacific. But so for next week, I'm going to be off. My daughter gets in Wednesday night, and then I'm out of touch for a week. I thought next Friday I'd pull from the archives the first time you were on the show, which was back in 2011, after we met up in DC at some Rebuild the American Dream or some event.
Oh, okay.
Right? Do you remember that?
I'm not. It's going to be a surprise to me. I'm sure I'm not going to remember it. So.
And then there was Capitol Hill lobbying day when we went up to members of the super committee, if you remember the super committee, who was talking about privatizing Medicare and all that stuff. And we went to Dave Camp's office where the legislative director lied to us. He told us the legislative director was with the congressman up at the Capitol, and it was him. And we had his name. You asked for his card because you lived in Michigan. It was just wild. We also went to my then congressman's office, Alan West, who had me arrested just a few weeks earlier at a so-called town hall meeting. So it was a fun day. So that was the first time you came on the show. So maybe I'll do that unless all hell breaks loose and something major happens and maybe we can do a quick segment, the record on Wednesday or something. Otherwise, we're going to have to wait another week.
All right. So, well, enjoy your time with your daughter.
Oh, I certainly will. And maybe you will get the screws removed from your foot, perhaps.
Maybe, yeah. Maybe I'll get rid of my not loose enough screw.
Okay, so either way, we'll keep you posted, and obviously just keep going to emptywheel.net and you'll be updated on everything in real time. Marcy Wheeler, always a pleasure. I'm both looking forward to the next few months and dreading them. So
I guess, buckle up. It's going to be crazy.
Yes, it is.